Number lines are an essential mathematical model. However, if you are like me, we didn't grow up doing math using number lines. And so if we didn't use it and we didn't learn that way, it becomes hard for us to do that with our students. I'm Christina Tonneville, the recovering traditionalist, and today we're going to take a look at my top five ways to use number lines in the math classroom. I hope you'll stick around as we build our math minds so that we can build the math minds of our students. So I'm going to give you the quick overview of the top five, and then I'm going to show some slides that show you what it looks like using a number line for these five things, okay? So our top five are rounding, which goes along with last week's blog post. If you didn't watch that, there's a link to it below this video that will take you to last week's video all about rounding using a number line. Addition and subtraction. We're going to talk about multiplication and division on a number line. We're also going to talk about how number lines build spatial relationships for our students. And then the last thing I want to talk about is using number lines to help kids understand percents and finding percent of type questions. Okay, so let's dig in to number one, rounding. All right, so I'm not going to go too in-depth on rounding because there is the other video that I'll link to that will give you more in-depth. But the whole idea is getting kids to place the number we're trying to round on the number line based upon the benchmark numbers that we're trying to think about. Does it round up to this amount or down to this amount? And if they can place it on a number line, that visual helps them to see which amount it's closest to. And it's a better way to start out than the way that I learned, which was if it's five or higher, you round up. So if you want more details, head back to the vlog post all about using number lines to round. Let's jump into the second one, which is adding and subtracting. There are lots of different strategies that kids will use when they're adding and subtracting, way different than when I grew up or even when I first started teaching. It was still about just learning the traditional algorithm. Now, the traditional algorithm is part of it, but part of what we're trying to do is let kids solve addition and subtraction, multiplication, division, any way that they can, as long as it's efficient and accurate. If it is based in their understanding, it's an okay way to solve the problem. So I want to show you some of those strategies that kids might come up with. And this is not all of them, but just some of them, and how the number line can really help kids to visualize it, not just the kids who are doing it, because they're seeing how all of these numbers work, but the number line can help the other kids understand what that kid was doing. So I'm going to start off with fractions, because fractions are not friendly sometimes, but one of the things that's helpful is that kids will want to make the fraction friendly. So if I'm adding 2 3/4 and I've got to add 3 2/4 onto that, one of the things that kids will do is say, man, if I just added a fourth, I could get to 3. And then once they're at 3, that's one of those kind of benchmark friendly numbers. Once they're there, it becomes really easy for them to just add the remaining piece of the 3 1/4 to get to their answer. So again, as I'm talking about these strategies, I don't think I said this explicitly, but these are not things you have to teach to kids. It's things that kids will naturally do if they understand numbers and how numbers work. Kids will do these strategies. And the number line is a great way for them to take what they're doing in their head and have a way to show it on paper. The number line is a notation. It's a model. The number line itself is not a strategy. There's nothing that tells me what to do on the number line. Kids will use them in different ways. All right, let's take a look at an example of subtraction. Okay, a lot of times kids will want to round one of those numbers to a friendly number. If one of the numbers is near a friendly number, they will want to round. The hard part with subtraction is once they get here, this becomes really easy. I know that the answer to that is 47. But the hard part is they don't know what to do next. They knew that they changed the problem, but they aren't quite sure how to undo what they did, right? They will say to themselves, oftentimes they will say, well, I added 11 to get to the 300, so I should subtract 11 because they feel like it needs to balance out. However, when we show it on a number line and we use that notation to show their strategy, and we show how they started at 347 and they jumped back 300, once we show that visual, a lot of times kids are like, wait, okay, wait, I jumped back too far. I went farther than I was supposed to, so I actually need to add the 11 back in. So a lot of times when kids are struggling and they've got a strategy part of the way, like they've got this idea, but it's not quite working right, having a visual model of that strategy can really help them understand it better. So a number line is always just seems to be a great strategy, a great notation to help them visualize the strategy. Okay, let's move into multiplication and division. And when it comes to multiplication, where kids first start out is that they see it as repeated addition or a skip counting, okay? And that's a fine place to start, but it is not the only way we want kids to view multiplication. It's not an additive process. Multiplication is a multiplicative comparison. You're multiplying an amount. So we want to also be attaching the groups of, this idea of groups of, just changing our wording a little bit, not just saying it's 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5, but it's one group of 5. Then it's two groups of 5 and three groups of 5 and so on. And I'm also a firm believer in, because number lines are a little abstract for our kiddos, so when you're first starting out, don't be surprised if number lines are not that easy for kids to use. And actually, number lines are recommended to start at second grade. So kindergarten and first grade should not be talking using number lines. Instead, next week, I'll talk about what we should be using instead of a number line. So just know that as kids in second, third grade are starting to use a number line, it may be a little abstract because we're asking kids to go from seeing visuals of 5 to now just having a big hop of 5. They're not seeing 5 things. So attaching these visuals can really help kids understand and have another visual to tie it to. Right. Now, when it comes to division, I'm going to use a context here to help us out, but because I like having stuff in context, and I think it's the best way to be doing mathematics in the classroom. But let's say we have a story problem like this, where Miss Kyle has 20 Jolly Ranchers, and students earn 5 Jolly Ranchers when they complete their AR points. So how many students can Miss Kyle give Jolly Ranchers to once they complete their points? Now, this idea, what kids will naturally do, even before they start officially doing division, is they will visualize those 20 Jolly Ranchers and say, okay, 5 goes to this kid and 5 goes to this kid. And so as kids are visualizing those 5 Jolly Ranchers going to one kid and 5 Jolly Ranchers going to another kid, it's nice to have a model to notate that thinking. And so a number line can be a great model for that thinking. And again, remember, it is kind of abstract. So we're starting at 20, and then they take away one group of 5. Then they've taken away 2 groups of 5, and they take away 3 groups of 5 until they get down to no Jolly Ranchers left. That's essentially what they do when they're physically modeling this problem with manipulatives. And then the number line is just a way to notate that thinking for kids. Okay. Spatial relationships is a really huge piece for kids and their understanding of how numbers relate to each other. Spatial relationships is about giving kids a visual, but talking about how those visuals relate. And so with small amounts, it's nice to just have visual pictures of, 7 and 5 and talking about what's the same and what's different. But as we move forward, we want to help kids use the number line as one of those visuals so that if they were to place 7 on this number line? Where would it go? How do you know it goes there? What does it tell you about how it relates to 10? Where would 5 go? Where would 12 go? All of those kinds of things, because it's a nice visual, but again, number lines are pretty abstract. So you want to first start with actual things where they can see 7 things in comparison to 10 things. However, as kids start moving up into larger amounts, we don't want them to have to draw 70 things in order to see how it compares to 100 things. So the number line gives us a model that is extendable, right? We can use it for all kinds of numbers that we are working with kids about. So we want to start with physical things, move to visual images, but then the number line can be a great visual to help us see relationships between amounts. And even when it comes to fractions, this becomes a huge visual for our kids. Number lines are a great visual for fractions and understanding how fractions relate to each other, right? If I wanted to place 3/4, where would I put it on that number line? And kids might partition, but then things like, if I wanted to place 13/16, where would I put that on the number line? Or even 15/16. I may not be asking the kids to partition it into 16ths. I want them to know that 15/16 is darn close to a whole, right? That's the idea, is that they can place things on this number line. It gives them a visual to then talk about how numbers relate to each other. Same thing as we go into decimals. We want kids to be able to know, and if I want to put 32/100 on this number line, where would it go? Does knowing how it relates to 50/100 or 1/2 help me out at all? So all of those pieces, it extends into all types of numbers that kids are going to work with. All right, the last one I'm going to talk about is percents, because oftentimes kids struggle with percents. And I will say, not even kids, but adults. I was the adult who was a math teacher, and when it came time to be figuring out the percent of tip that I need to leave for a waiter or waitress, I was pulling out my cell phone to figure it out, because I didn't have any visuals. I didn't have any strategies for figuring out percents. And a number line is a great way to do that. And what it essentially becomes is a double number line. So we start out with this idea of 0 to 100, but that 100 is really 100%, or the whole amount we're working with, right? So if my bill was $24, right, I could figure out lots of things on here, but not even just in that scenario of a bill. What if I just wanted to know 50%, right? Would being able to place this on a number line help me out? 50% should be half, right? And so what's half of the 24? Now, most of the time, hopefully they know that fairly quickly, but then we can use that visual to help us with other things like 25% or 1/4, right? We want kids to be able to visualize where that would fall on the number line and use that to help them out. And we start with friendly amounts, but then you can move to things that maybe aren't as friendly and show them on the number line. Okay. Now here's a typical problem that we do with percents. Miss Thompson has 12 Labradors. This is 20% of all her show dogs. How many show dogs does she have? When I was in school, we were taught to set this up as an equation and, you know, figure out what goes on one side of the equal sign, figure out what the unknown is. And once I learned that I could show this on a number line, it changed everything for me. It helped me so much in understanding percents of, right? In this story, I know that 12 Labradors is 20% of what she has for show dogs. And that's what I've modeled on the number line. From there, the goal is to figure out what's 100%. How many show dogs does she have? Well, the cool part about once it's here is that kids will figure it out in lots of different ways and in ways that build their number sense. They aren't just computing, because remember, it's about building math minds, not just creating calculators.
I could plug this into a calculator and get the answer. I want to encourage my kids to be thinkers, not just calculators. Yes, I want them to get the answer. Yes, I want them to calculate it, but I want them to build their math mind while they do that. So you might see kids from here say, well, if 20% is 12, 40% would be double that. And then if I double that, that gets me 80%. And then when I get 80%, all I have to do is add that 20% on to figure out what the 100% would be. You might have some kids who don't see it that way and they say, man, I can just have that 20%. That would give me 10%. And once I know 10%, that can tell me what 100% is. Right? They're using their number sense, but the number line is helping them visualize this idea, right? To build their understanding while they're also computing and figuring out the answer. Now, I will say that this is not a complete list. If you have a favorite way that you love to use number lines that I did not talk about, let us know down in the comments. Or if you have a favorite activity, link to it down in the comments. Help all of us build our math minds, because this is not the only way to use number lines in the classroom. Just my top five. So if you want a short little summary of each of these in a PDF download, there's a link below this video and at the bottom of the vlog post where you can request a download of it that will give you these top five ways and show some visuals along with it. All right. Well, as always, I hope this helped you build your math mind so you can build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.